Learning from Normal Work podcast with Dr. Marcin Nazaruk.
Welcome to the podcast that helps safety practitioners take real-world action. I'm Dr. Marcin Nazaruk, and today we are talking with Amanda Makar from International Paper, a global pulp and paper company, about her journey to apply learning from normal work in practice. Amanda, welcome. Please tell us a few words about you, your company, and your journey to implement proactive learning.
All right. Good morning. My name is Amanda Makar. I am the safety manager at our Bogalusa paper mill that is for International Paper. I've been with this company about 6 years now, and I've been in this role for about a year and a half. So we started on our journey with learning events and looking into normal work and learning teams just about 2 years ago. Really diving in there and starting to look at all the different topics that we can help reduce risk. And
excellent. Thank you so much. We can't wait to hear your story.
Thank you. All right. So I will just go through some of the information that at the Bogalusa paper mill. So far, our mill has completed 13 proactive learning events, which has been an unbelievable journey. We've had so much improvement from the first one that we started all the way up until actually we have one going on today. So using all of these team members to investigate and figure out a way on how to reduce risk during these tasks. We've also had about 7 post-injury learning events, which we hope to have more proactive instead of post-injury. But obviously, when there is an injury that does occur, we want to make sure that it doesn't happen again. So we do use those opportunities to walk through what happened and how we can prevent that. So I just want to show you on this screen, you'll see that we have 20 different, I just pulled a few examples that we've completed. And at our facility, we actually have 3 different departments. So we have the paper, pulp, and utilities department, which in each of those, very different tasks, very different hazards. And so we try to go through each department and pick very specific ones that each of our employees might bring to us and say, hey, you know, I think this is where our next injury is going to occur in this department. So you'll see some of the acronyms that are up there, PM for paper machine. We've had a few things such as our wood yard. We have a lot of truck drivers that come in and out of here. So we have one that we did around our truck driver safety, around the chip pile and our dozer, things such as we even completed a TIFRA, which is identified as a traffic flow risk assessment. So we have a ton of mobile equipment out here that we have over 500 employees at our facility. So you can imagine on an average day, we have maybe 100, 150 out here walking around. And so making sure that we can prevent them from having any interaction with mobile equipment. So these are just a few examples, like I said, that we're continuing to work through. That have really stood out to me.
Excellent. You mentioned that you went through the departments and you asked people about the concerns. I think that is a fantastic way of prioritizing where to focus, because it's the people who know the areas of the biggest concern to them. But tell me more, how do you do that in practice? How do you go about, who do you ask in those divisions? Because in every department you will have, I presume, more than one person to ask.
Right.
Tell us more about this aspect.
So on my team, I have about 5, we call them safety advocates, but they are our hourly workforce safety employees who are in those departments and they represent safety in the field. So, you know, if it were up to me, I wish I could be out in the field all the time, but they're more of the eyes and they see this stuff happen all the time. Their employees that they're working with, their hourly force, feel comfortable going to them about issues and concerns. They're more accessible than probably some of us upper management out here. And so what I started off with is when we first came up with this process, I said, you know, go out into the field, talk with the hourly employees, each different shift, because we have 4 shifts. So go through and ask them, you know, on your everyday rounds that you're making, on the tasks that you go through when we have machine or equipment go down, or if we have contractors mm-hmm. coming in to work on something, whatever those tasks are, what stand out to you the most that you feel are hazardous, you feel that mm-hmm. you get a little uncomfortable, or you feel like there's going to be an injury there soon, mm-hmm. or mm-hmm. there might have been one, but it wasn't reported. So mm-hmm. I ask them to really kind of go out there and ask those people. And at first it was kind of a slower process. Some people maybe didn't want to speak up or give ideas as much, but as we slowly mm-hmm. started to put these out there and share the information and process of this, more and more people actually have come to them or come to me even and said, hey, I have an idea, a process that I want to do a learning event for.
That's in my experience, I also seen that one of the most effective ways of prioritizing the focus. So thank you for sharing.
Yes, of course. So I just have some pictures that I wanted to walk through up on the slide around the process that we go through for these learning teams. And, you know, it's not easy. It's not. And at first, you know, it was a struggle for us trying to get that buy-in from that hourly workforce of, you know, this isn't just another safety requirement that we want to just put out there and a permit that's going to be a check the box. This is something that we want their feedback and their participation on finding the solution on how to make this task more mm-hmm. safe. So mm-hmm. a lot goes into prepping for these learning events, such as going out into the field and taking pictures and watching the task be done. Those observations, we call them field trips. During the learning events, making sure we're getting creative. So the one up in the middle that I have here is a drawing that actually one of our hourly employees wanted to draw up for us and create the rigging tool that they need for this specific task. And so, you know, them coming in there and drawing that out for us and knowing exactly what they need to make that job safe was huge. We were able to get an engineer come in and stamp that for us so that they can design it, build it, and use it in the field. And they can be proud of that they were a part of the solution and that they're working safe, but they were part of that safety there. Mm. So that was an example of one that we did. You'll see at the bottom corner, we had a few injuries last year and near misses, which we call them almost incidents, basically. Nobody was hurt, but it was a close call. So getting on and off of this huge piece of equipment, it sounds easy, but let me tell you, I got up there and it's not easy. So we, you know, talked.
Yeah.
We actually brought in all the employees that drive this piece of equipment and we brought them out into the field and we said, I want you to just get on the equipment and get off the equipment, just like you would any other day, any other shift. And kind of go through the motions and where their hands are being placed and where their footing is being placed. And it was interesting to kind of see them almost like watch the other people do it and watch themselves doing it and see that, okay, wait, maybe my hand placement could be different where I could reach it and make sure that if I were to slip, at least I still have this handle. And mm-hmm. so, you know, that's another example we used with our D9 dozers. Yeah. And then like, the last picture in the right top-hand corner was an interesting one. That was actually one of our first learning events around our bark dumps. So we have trucks come in from the outside. They come in with bark in the back of their trucks, and we have them back up onto a ramp, which then once they get out of their vehicle, the ramp raises and it dumps the chips. And we had a lot of issues with truck drivers maybe backing up too far, not visually being able to see where they need to back up to. And so we actually, not only did we bring our employees in, but we brought some truck drivers in. So, you know, mm-hmm. we said to them, hey, we're doing a learning event, which is basically walking through this process. And you guys are the ones that are driving those trucks. You're a huge part of this process. So they were able to come in and kind of walk us through the struggles they're having so that we can identify all the different safety hazards and concerns and put something in place for that.
Fantastic.
Yeah. So I won't talk too much about this, but basically it's just a step through of what we follow for all of our learning events. You know, it's super important for us that we don't get too specific on how every single learning event learning team should be or what they should do, because each topic and each process that they're looking at is different. And so there might be one that needs a full day because it's a longer process. Mm-hmm. Or if there's a smaller task that just needs more detail or a little fix to it, something that they maybe already have in mind. And so we kind of started off with this process. A few things that do stand out to the way we go about our learning events is making sure our mill manager, he comes in, he's our highest leader out here, and he opens up to the group and just starts off with how important these are and how important some of the information that they share and being honest and going through that there's no discipline. You know, being honest is only going to help us in the long run. If we don't know what's happening out in the field during that task, we're not going to be able to fix it. So he goes through that, which is awesome. That really speaks to our employees that are out in the field, seeing him come in there and talk through that. So we always make sure we're having him in there. And then one of the other parts that sticks out to me is the gray area, which I'm sure you've kind of talked through it as well a few times. That area where someone might drift to because of issues or something as simple as somebody being in a bad mood because they didn't get enough sleep and they just want to be done with the job and done with the process and be able to go home and hang out with their family. And so we have to focus on, okay, what can we put in place for situations like that that do happen? It's the reality. They do happen. And so thinking about that gray area, that drift, is something we always make sure we bring up during these learning events.
Excellent. Yeah. I think that having the structure is very important. From the opening by a senior leader to setting ground rules, explaining the context and going through the activity. So thank you for sharing how you do that.
I think, you know, I know I haven't been in this role in my career for too long, but I have seen such an increase of, I would say, think of the right word. I've just seen that management is now focusing more on the people in the field, the ones doing the task. And I have that little image up at the top that talks about the sharp end, the workers that are doing the jobs. You know, the mill manager, he might be over the whole mill, but he knows that he's not the one doing that task every day. So he's not going to be able to fix it, just like say a safety manager won't be able to. So I think we are moving in the right direction. The company has been really focusing on this stuff, and I think it's a great opportunity for everybody.
Very good.
So I have some more pictures here, and I kind of just want to touch base on two of them that really stick out to me for specific examples with our learning events. So if you'll see in the middle, I say that the problem statement determines the type of learning event we hold. So a mini or a full day learning event. And that's something our facility went with that's working well for us. My manager and myself sat down and, you know, it's really hard to keep focus in a room for a whole day with some of these shift guys out here, guys and girls. And, you know, they want to come in and they might already feel really passionate about something. So if they feel like they might have a good idea already in place, we might make it a mini one. When I say mini, we mean maybe a half day, an hour or two, get the right people in the room, quick facts, stuff like that. So that's what basically what I'm referring to when I say mini or full day learning event. You'll see in this top left corner, this one was actually very interesting to me. I had my coworker, David Hodge, he went ahead and he facilitated this learning event. And it was around the bark chute that is out in our pulp, in our wood yard, in our bark department. And basically, you can kind of see that the bark falls down this big chute. And what's happening in this picture is that because the inside of the chute is deteriorating, there's ridges and holes, and it hasn't been worked on in a while. The material and the lining of it isn't really doing what its purpose is anymore. And so when the crew came in there and talked through it, I really couldn't understand. So this lining on the inside is the reason why it's building up like this, which is causing us to have our maintenance employees complete this task, which is removing a door from that top left picture. You'll see there's that big opening. There's usually a door that's on there. And that door is heavy and it's high up. And so not only do they have to get in a man lift, they have to be tied off. They have to lift this huge door off of there. And then they can try to fix the problem by unclogging the inside of this chute. And, you know, talking through it with them, my first thing was, all right, how can we make that process better? But in the end, we ended up realizing, well, we wouldn't even have to do this process if we just fixed the actual problem, the lining inside the chute. And so we talked through all of that. We actually got their manager involved and brought him into the room. And we said, what kind of lining is there out there? You know, I don't know those details, but they do on something we can get inside this chute that can help it from clogging and minimize that risk. Because if we minimize that task, then we're minimizing the amount of times they have to do this and that they have to get up on working at heights and using this pole and all these other issues that could lead to a safety incident. So it was really interesting to see this one that, you know, here we are talking about a process, but it doesn't even need to happen if we fix this issue. And so we can take away that total risk overall doing the whole thing if we can remove that.
Excellent. That's a fantastic example also of the elimination level in the hierarchy of controls.
Yes, exactly. Another example that you'll see on the bottom left corner. So another employee, actually, another drawing that we came up with. We had a group out here basically walk us through what it's like for them to pull a sample. And so in our facility, there's a lot of chemicals and hazards around heat and temperature of different liquids. And so when they have to catch these samples, you're dealing with not only burns, but it can be acidic, it could, any kind of chemical that can cause a serious incident. But we still, we need to do this process in order to make sure that in the end, we can make good paper. So we installed these sample boxes that, you know, we just kind of put in there, we need to catch these samples. But we brought the group in and they said, you know, this is what we need. We need to be able to see what we're doing, but still be safe doing it. And so we actually, we started to talk through some examples and, okay, inside these boxes, what does it look like? And what do you need to see? And how can you get your hand with the cup in there, but still have your hand protected? And so all these different things started coming out. And one employee just said, can I just draw this for you? And so, you know, we had him draw the example he was thinking of. And then another employee at drew another example. And so we came, we narrowed it down to, we call them SOP for design A and B. And in the end, we actually got with our maintenance, our mechanics out here, and they were able to come up with a design with the right metal and the plexiglass. We installed about two or three of them, and then we had our employees test it out to make sure it was exactly what they wanted and that it was keeping them safe still. They were able to see what they were doing, but still be safe. So that was really interesting to see because, you know, when I walked out there, I like to go see the process before I have a learning event. And watching it, I never would have thought, okay, they need a hole on the side that they can put their hand in that has, you know, drapes over it and a window in front. You know, I would just say, well, you know, is there any way we don't have to catch the samples maybe or something like that? Just, you know, eliminate it completely. But they know that process so well out there and they know what they do every day and what struggles they might run into.
Fantastic. And so one of the challenges to address it in the way described is to engage different team members. You probably need an engineer, a manager, a safety professional, a worker, and even some others. What were some challenges that you faced when it comes to gauging those different people and how you overcome them?
Yeah, so we definitely, you know, at first, when we first started doing these, we said, okay, you know, out here in our facility, if we're going to look at any of these tasks or processes, we need to get operations and maintenance involved. And so, you know, each learning event we do, we usually bring in at least one from each, depending if it's a maintenance task or an operations task. And then we started to realize, okay, so we can bring these people in, they're the ones doing the job, we can come up with a solution, but we know that a lot of the times, some of this stuff might cost money. We always know that there's going to be a cost around some stuff. So, you know, from a manager standpoint, I needed to make sure that I had the buy-in and everything for my management team, that the leadership here, that they understood, you know, we're going to go out there and we're going to try to fix these problems, but we need to be able to show that we can have these action items completed, and that whatever we come up with, that if maybe we can't get something done tomorrow, maybe because it's a capital project and it's going to cost more, what can we put in place smaller, an interim control, something like that. So definitely bridging that gap between the hourly workforce and then our leadership was something that we needed to make sure everybody was on the same page about. And as we started to complete some of these action items and we share that information out in the field, and they're seeing, okay, my leadership is all in for this. If I feel like this is going to fix my safety and reduce the risk during this process, then they're all for it. And so that was probably our biggest challenge around that group. And then when it comes to, we're starting to realize more and more that maybe an engineer, or we have a program at International Paper that we have REACH engineers, which are younger college graduates who are right out of school, and they come in and they do rotations through each department. And we've started to have them come into the learning events and listen in and listen to the process, because a lot of the times they're working on cost reduction projects. And so it's kind of interesting how you can tie some of these departments into these learning events. And if, you know, you get the right people in there, everybody can help with the situation. So stuff like the box that they designed, we had to bring in an engineer and a mechanical maintenance employee to make sure, okay, is this the right material that we can use for this temperature and stuff like that. So it definitely, all hands on deck, honestly. At first we thought it was just going to be just those few operational people, one safety person, and then we'll be good to go. But everybody out here has actually been starting to get involved from all different kinds of departments, which is awesome.
Fantastic. Congratulations. That's a great achievement.
Yes, thank you. So I just wanted to kind of pat ourselves on the back for what we've accomplished here so far around these learning events. Like I was just saying, you know, we got a lot of people involved, not just the safety department, not just my safety advocates. And as you can see, I just pull up these two pictures, because there's one room that on the right-hand side, you see on the back of his shirt, says trainee. That's an employee who actually was involved in an incident. So he was part of the post-injury learning event. And he had only been here for less than 6 months. So we have someone in there less than 6 months, all the way up to, there was an employee in there that's been there for 30 years. So, you know, just kind of getting that bottom job all the way up to that top job, the senior and the, we call them sometimes the green employees. So employees that are in training or newer. And so making sure we get all of those people involved. And I mean, we've accomplished so much so far with our action items and making sure we close them out, reducing risk out here. And then really sharing those results, I think, has been a huge part of it, too. So getting our communications manager involved to make sure that not only the people involved in that learning event know that there's stuff being done and what they came in there and spent time on is being completed, but everybody out there can say, oh, you know, these learning events seem to be going well. Maybe there's an opportunity for me to bring a process or a task that we do to have some discussion around it.
Fantastic. That's a truly cross-departmental effort.
Yes, for sure. And, you know, you had asked me earlier around some challenges that we've faced going through this process. And, you know, we might be in a good spot right now, but it took a lot of different people and effort and time from everybody out here to make sure that we really follow through with this process. And I think we kind of touched base on each one of these, keeping it simple and define scope and narrow. So those kind of tie in together. Mm-hmm. But really, you know, like I said, maybe doing a mini or a full day learning event, you mm-hmm. know, and I'll talk in a few minutes about one specifically. But while we're doing a learning event, we might come up with another idea, another hazard that we might run into. But there's always mm-hmm. more time to extend those. Appropriate people, like we were saying, appropriate people such as cross management, maintenance, operations, safety, everybody really out here taking part mm-hmm. in these learning events and being a part of how we can make our people work more safe, give them mm-hmm. more opportunity to work safely out here. Mm-hmm. And then that honesty and no discipline. And, you know, that one, that was hard at first for all of us to really buy into that. I think that mm-hmm. it was at first a struggle for maybe leadership out here to, you know, how do we be okay if somebody brings to us that something happened, but it wasn't reported? And that, I mean, mm-hmm. being a safety manager out here, if I hear of a safety incident that I didn't, mm-hmm. that I wasn't aware of, that wasn't reported, mm-hmm. makes me uncomfortable, but yeah. So it is happening. And so we need to change something. Thankfully, somebody wasn't injured, but could have been. And so it makes yeah. us really think through all of that. And, you know, those hourly employees really have to trust this process to be able to yeah. open up and really walk through all of that.
Yeah. Tell me more how you as the management team overcome this challenge. Because, okay, I'm having a learning team and somebody tells me we broke the rules, we work under suspended load, or we did something that is, you know, that shouldn't be done from the managerial point of view, of course, because right. there are typically more than one perspective. But it makes leaders uncomfortable and, of course, wanting to take different actions. How did you overcome that and how you currently think about things like that when somebody in the learning team tells you we didn't follow that rule or something else undesired happened?
Right. So it was a struggle at first, I would say, because from my standpoint, I had to go to the leadership and say, if we're going to do this, everybody has to be okay with what I'm going to report out on after an incident, after a learning event. I go in and whether it's myself or a few other facilitators that are in the safety field, so maybe one of our safety advocates, we do a report out to that leadership and that department on what was discussed and what we found and what we would like to do to help reduce risk in that process or task. Mm-hmm. And at first, you know, it was kind of hesitant. And even from like an HR perspective, you know, saying, well, how do we be okay with if they come to us and say they didn't report something? So we basically said, well, at least we're knowing, we're learning about it now. And then part of our duty is to make sure that it doesn't happen again. And so, you know, mm-hmm. we can't reverse and we can't go in the past. We just have to keep moving forward. And so at first, you know, I thought the leadership would maybe be the hardest to kind of get that buy-in and be okay with it. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. in the end, when I first started doing these learning events, silence in the room was hard because mm-hmm. it was people were scared to speak up, scared mm-hmm. to tell mm-hmm. the truth and, you know, mm-hmm. and everything. And I basically would just have to make our meal manager, he comes in, he does that opening. And then myself after he leaves and I say, you know, what is discussed and stays in this room. And mm-hmm. it was really building a relationship as a facilitator, I think, is a huge mm-hmm. part of it. Because we talked through when this process was brought to us by IP's leadership in safety, it was really crucial to us on who the facilitators are going to be. Because, mm-hmm. you know, we kind of talked through if you have HR as the facilitator, you probably aren't going to have people open up. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, if yeah. you had their specific manager, maybe they wouldn't. And so it was kind mm-hmm. of making sure who is going to be the right person to facilitate these mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. make sure that that honesty does come out. And it definitely took some time. And from my standpoint, I can talk through hearing, you never want to hear that somebody might have been injured or an incident happened that you didn't know of that wasn't reported. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it, it makes you uncomfortable, but it also, the way to tell them, if we report it, if we don't know about it, we can't do anything to change it. So really looking at, okay, what happened and what did you do to make sure that you weren't more severely injured or you, it didn't happen again? You know, what can we do to change that outcome? And I think a lot of it has to go into building that relationship, really getting them to open up. And, you know, I recently did one that an employee mentioned how they had an incident where they fell and, you know, it was kind of a close call and everything. And at first him and the other employees were like laughing and like, kind of like, oh, that was a close one, you know, but then he was like, but you know, that was a close one. And it, you know, I got lucky. And we talk about that luck and something I started doing. There's a slide that I bring up during my learning events that I facilitate. And it says, just because you drove to work and got here safely doesn't mean you drove here safe. And I think as someone else had brought that up once before, and I started thinking through it, and you know, everybody here drives to work, and just because they got here and they're got here alive and they're about to start work and they're good to go doesn't mean that they didn't run a red light, didn't you know, swerve off of the road, stuff like that. So we kind of talked through that. It was definitely a challenge, but more people are opening up and, you know, realizing that if they don't, then we're not going to be able to fix this.
Fantastic. Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you. And then I just have two examples that I kind of want to get a little bit more specific around that I've dealt with a learning team recently. So a little background to this one is our paper machine basement Pulper belt replacement. So we have two paper machines here at the Bogalusa mill, and in our basement on one of our older machines is a Pulper belt. So you'll see on that top left corner an image, and you can kind of see that there's five conveyor belts that go north to south, and they're there when we have our excess paper that falls from above, that paper that we're going to reuse in our process and recycle goes into the pulper. And so on those belts, this heavy paper, you know, it could be, we're running heavy weight. So it could be really heavy paper or it could be lighter. It could be wet. It could get really heavy on these belts and can wear them down. And so walking through this process, the reason why we had this learning event was actually because what happened was we had really heavy weight paper. It was left on these belts for a good bit of time, which caused one of the belts to tear. And so they had to go up there, our maintenance employees, and they had to change one of the belts. And we had an employee actually observe what they were doing and ask the question of why they were not wearing fall protection. And, you know, they're further than 15 feet, but close to the pulper, which is basically you go down and that's where it stirs up all the old paper. So if they fall and these belts are running, they're not running fast, but they are moving. So somebody could fall onto the belt and then fall into the hole, which obviously would be tragic. And so they asked the question and called the safety department about it and was, you know, what's this? And I said, you know, I don't know exactly what the process you're talking about. I'm going to have to go out there and maybe see it and try to understand it a little bit more. And after talking with their manager of the one who was doing this process, you know, kind of started to say, hey, maybe this might be a good opportunity for a learning event because I think there's some stuff here that we have to look at. There's a lot of risk that makes a safety manager uncomfortable. And so we actually brought the maintenance group in there, and there was about six of them, all from, you know, one that actually is really close to retirement, all the way down to an employee who just fell into that role in the last 2 months. So different mm-hmm. people in there. I had an operations person in there just to, you know, kind of give some feedback to us as well. Mm-hmm. And we started talking through different fall protection measures and, you know, how have we been doing this job for so long, but never been tied off mm-hmm. and, you know, had some sort of fall protection. And actually one of the employees had brought up to me, oh, you know, back in the day, I actually fell once and I had to roll off of the belt onto the area where it wasn't moving. And, mm-hmm. you know, like I was saying earlier, he, you know, at first was kind of, oh, it's, you know, not a big deal. But then he was like, well, that could happen again. And that could happen to somebody else. Mm-hmm. And it could mm-hmm. end very bad. So, you know, they were at first really not interested, did not want to change their process, did not want to have to put a harness on and add to being uncomfortable and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. But mm-hmm. we found the right tool for them, the right mm-hmm. lifeline and the ability to make them move freely as they need to, but still be tied off and still have that protection that if they were to fall, mm-hmm. they're tied mm-hmm. off and that they wouldn't fall and go mm-hmm. into that area. Mm-hmm. So that was the main part of the learning event. But the cool thing about this one was that it actually brought light to the process itself and why we run into these belts breaking so much. And it brought up another concern by this group that started talking through. You'll see that picture of that yellow gate system mm-hmm. that is underneath the belts where they have to go and while they're making rounds every single shift, they call it, they have to mm-hmm. trail the belts. So they have to make sure that they're aligned properly, that they're not headed towards one side or the other, which will then lead to them breaking or ripping. And so if we can have continuous maintenance done and people looking at this, making sure they're trailing the belts each shift, then we won't have belts that are ripping and breaking and have to go to this process. So, but their issue and concern was it's really hard for them to get into that area. As you could see, it's very crammed, small, tight. Mm-hmm. Luckily, they do have a brighter light in there now, but it's still a dark area. They have to go down there with two people to make sure that they're keeping an eye on one another because you're entering a machine boundary. And so they started talking through that and, you know, myself and my other safety coworker were both turning our heads. Why did we decide as a mill to put that specific machine guarding in there? Why is that gate mm-hmm. what we mm-hmm. went with? And so we kind of mm-hmm. did some research looking back and we did that as you're entering an area that's hazardous. So we want to keep people out of there. So that's what we went with mm-hmm. that gate design a couple years back. But I think when we did that, we forgot to ask maintenance. You mm-hmm. forgot to get those mm-hmm. people involved mm-hmm. and ask them, hey, we're going to put something up that's probably going to change your process. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. we got with actually one of our corporate safety subject matter experts on machine guarding. And I ran an idea mm-hmm. by him that the maintenance employees came up with. And I said, you know, we have this guard that was recently put on another piece of equipment in another department that they were looking at and would fit really well on all these belts, which if it met the requirement and they were able to access them easier, they wouldn't have to get crammed into that area. We'd be able to remove the gates because it would still protect those net points, those guarding and rotating equipment, but it would make their process a lot safer. They wouldn't, the heat down mm-hmm. there and the uncomfortable body position. So we got his blessing and we're moving forward with putting those guards in. So it was interesting to see the group go from an observation was made, a task mm-hmm. was brought to us, a solution was found, but we found another hazard that really mm-hmm. helps lead to that. And so it kind of all circles in and, mm-hmm. you know, in the end, we're able to help them in two different ways. We're making the process more safe when they're on that top portion. And mm-hmm. then when they have to do the other part of their task with the belts, that they're able to access mm-hmm. them safer, but mm-hmm. their body position is better. They're able to see better down there. And so it was a huge applaud for us on kind of finding an observation in the field from an employee who was just walking around to making two processes more safe.
No, definitely. And it's very impressive that somebody admitted openly that they fell.
Yeah.
Because I think this can be interpreted in a way as a gift.
Yeah.
To do something about, or as a violation or a problem, and right. may lead to completely different reactions. So it's fantastic to see how you created enough psychological safety for people to talk openly about that, and then how you involve people in the solution. And another reflection based on this story is what I see a lot is a control was implemented without involving key stakeholders in right. seeing the impact of that control. And in some cases I've seen where a good idea creates actually big problems and increases risk rather than reduce the risk because of the implication and the impact that it has on people. So that's a great example. And you had another one for us, right?
Yes, I have one more. It's actually in the paper department as well. That was another one that stood out to me that we got a lot of people involved in. We actually, this came out of a little bit of the background to it, is our paper machine boundary line. So 2 years ago, I think this one was, we actually had an environmental health and safety audit. So each year, our safety department, we have the audit team from corporate come out here and they go through a bunch of auditing all of our safety policies and processes. We take them out into the field and we actually were standing there with our auditor and she observed an employee doing something that made her uncomfortable that she had us, we asked some questions around the safety around it. And if you see in that top middle picture, there's a few things going on there. So you have our big paper, the roll, it's going spinning round and round very fast. And then below it is a hole. It's an opening. That's where actually from the previous event that we were just talking about, it's where that paper falls. If we're not going to use it, we're going to recycle. It'll fall into that hole and go into the basement. But we have the yellow bar that goes across that is a machine boundary barrier. It's a guard. It's supposed to be able to stop if somebody were to fall. That's there guarding that. And then we also had that red paint that is to warn people, hey, you're getting close to a hole, a fall hazard. So just kind of as a visual for people. And we did not have at that time that yellow warning line that's going across the yellow and black, looks like caution tape almost. We did not have that. And we had an employee who was using their feet to push paper into that hole, which at other facilities or there's been instances, I'm sure, at paper mills that when you're using your feet, it might be slippery and there could be potential for somebody to fall. And if they were to fall into that hole, that would be a safety issue itself. And so she started asking us questions and, you know, our team had to come up with a solution of how can we prevent people from pushing paper with their feet, making sure they realize they're getting really close to an area with a hole. And it brought up a ton of other safety concerns that we didn't realize at that time as well. So when we have an auditor come in here and audit something like that, me as a safety manager, I need to put something in place right away. You know, whether it's going to be our permanent fix or our temporary fix, we need to put something in place to make sure we keep our people safe. And our quick fix really was putting this warning cross line across so that when they're pushing that paper, they realize there's paint there to show that it's getting close, but also that warning line that's at that chest level height to be able to show them you're getting too close. You should not be entering that area. And part of that as well is we have a pedestrian path that walks right past that. And so, you know, talking through with my group, we kind of came up with a solution and didn't ask the group out there, the group that's working in that area all the time. And that didn't go over well. You know, we implemented something that changed their process and we didn't ask them about what they thought or any idea that they had. So we kind of put a halt on everything and brought each shift their entire shift that works in that area in and had a meeting with each of them, a learning event to go through. This is the hazard that was found. This is our temporary fix because we have to do something today to make sure it doesn't happen tomorrow. But what other ideas, what other hazards are in this area? What are y'all running into that we can help with and try to fix this unsafe condition? And so we actually ended up doing a TIFRA, which is a traffic flow risk assessment, to determine, is this route the best for pedestrians to be walking through this area? Is there somewhere else? And, you know, can we put up a better warning sign? Do we need more signage for people who maybe don't go through that area all the time, don't realize what hazards are around them? And so a lot of stuff came out of that one. And it was very interesting because, you know, we had to take a step back as the safety team and realize we can implement something that's not going to change my everyday. And it's going to make me maybe feel better about a unsafe condition, but it's going to change the process for those people who are working in that area every day. So getting them involved in that one, that was one of our first lessons learned, to make sure we have the right people involved. Hearing from everybody, they came up with great ideas and different situations that we changed. The hard part with some of these is we're a over 100-year-old facility, and some of these areas we can't, I guess, their design and the layout, a lot of the times, if it's too small, if there's only one route to go down, we might not be able to change a pedestrian path. So there was a lot of different conversations brought up, a lot of different policies. We updated a bunch of information, communicated more with the people working in that area. So that was a huge plus for us. That it was a learning experience for sure.
Thank you. That's a great example. And it shows the important role of the safety profession and safety professionals who, with best intentions, according to best standards, may implement something. And yet, because of how it interacts with other pieces, with other processes, steps in the task, etc., how it may create unintended problems, and in some occasions maybe even increase the risk. But you've got a fantastic example showing how getting people involved in that conversation helps to prevent such an issue and come up with something that they support and are more likely to use, and ultimately something that reduces the risk. Amanda, so this is fantastic. I think it's very impressive what you've done, and big congratulations for giving all those different shifts and changes that you needed to have in place to get this learning and get those insights. Just before we close, at the very beginning, you mentioned that you applied your learning events proactively and also in response to incidents. Could you share with us your experience with incident investigations versus learning events? When something happens, are you still doing your 5Y, or have you completely transitioned now to learning events? And how do you see learning from incidents before you started this effort and now when you were doing it?
I would focus on something that we've kind of gone away from here at the Bogalusa Mill is, instead of when an incident happens, one of the first questions that people were asking was who. And it was, you know, that who might have not have mattered on who that person, the name of that person, but it was, are they a new hire? Have they been here for 30 years doing that task and they should know how to do that? And, you know, they should know that that's a hazard and whatnot. And I think we did that just because we didn't know what other questions to ask and, you know, how to start to break down exactly what happened and not who happened. So I think from the incident investigation, when we've done post injuries, the hard part with those ones is assumptions. And if we can get the person that was involved in the injury, if they can be part of that to kind of share exactly what was going on through their head, or what other outside issues or concerns kind of tied into maybe what occurred. And so we've struggled a little bit with that in the beginning, but I think the employees just being honest and kind of saying, this is what happened to me and I want to help prevent it from happening to anybody else. So this is what truly happened and this is what we need to work on to make sure it doesn't happen again. And so we still focus on investigating what happened and getting down to the details, but also just not staying in the past and, you know, continuing to ask the who, more of what happened, what can we change today and implement to make sure we have all these different layers of protection in place.
Fantastic. Well, it's been amazing listening to your story. And I think our listeners have a lot to learn from your experience. So Amanda, thank you so very much for coming, joining the podcast and for sharing your story and your journey.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it so much. I've learned a lot from listening to you at the conference and looking through all your website and taking those courses. I think overall in the safety field, and especially at, I know IP and Bogalusa, our paper mill, we're really focusing on this process and trusting the process. And I think overall, it's made a huge difference for us. And I think for everyone, it'll take their own path and own journey on how they use this process, but it works. It really does.
Excellent.